844.
He's got his own thing going on and has well before he knew me.
Yeah, but all your coaches are their own thing, right?
Absolutely. Okay. That's the point I wanted to make. And so Steve actually is the owner of Underdog 704, which is a company here in town that focuses on startup businesses. So I know Steve's favorite thing is to help people with startups, but he's got lots of other skills that he does, just like a lot of the coaches that I work with. Lots of things from LinkedIn to niche marketing to copywriting and blogging and you name it. So definitely one of my favorite people from a coaching perspective and just a great all-around person. So I knew your guest would definitely, or your audience would definitely enjoy him for sure.
Steve, thank you so much, buddy, for being on the show. I do appreciate it, my friend.
My pleasure. Thanks. Thank you.
We've been talking through email and meeting at networking events for 4 or 5 months now. I don't know how we got connected to start. Was it Kalani that pushed us together?
Probably Catlow.
Well, it might have been Michael. I don't know.
I heard you speak not too very long ago, and you were kind enough to send me a copy of your book.
Oh, that's right. That's right. You were at one of those little networking functions.
Exactly.
I said something. Okay, great. Yeah, cool. Steve, thank you so much for coming. Let me see if I understand. Underdog Business Strategies, I understand it to be a small business advisory coaching platform for small business people starting out. That's the way I understood your business. Am I even close?
You're right on target. Okay. You're right on target.
So talk a little bit about your background. How did you become this expert in starting and helping people start small businesses?
I became that way out of necessity. I had to do it. I escaped the mortgage industry back in 2007, and when it imploded, I got out of it. And I came down here to Charlotte, thought I'd go find a new job. Finding a new job in 2008 was really not a great idea. And so I had this game plan to go meet 100 people. And the purpose of that was, what do you do for a living? I wonder if I could do that. Because I was literally looking for something, some way to take advantage of the experience and the talent that I have and try to figure out where to go play. And as I got to meet these 100 people, I kept meeting these solopreneurs, these freelancers, these people with these crazy ideas going, well, this is what I want
to
do.
Okay, did you get to 100?
Oh, easily.
Okay.
Yep. And the guy that wrote the book told me that you should tell people that you're on a mission to meet 100 people because they're going to ask you.
That's kind of neat.
What number am I?
Yeah.
And I didn't believe him. I didn't believe that was ever going to happen. And finally, in one of the meetings, I did ask. So I told them I was on a mission to meet 100 people. And they said, really, what number am I? You got to be kidding.
I love that. What is the name of the book? I have not heard that book, but I love the concept.
The author's name is James Davis, and I think it's called The $100,000 Career
or
something.
Watch this. I'm going to show you something. Kalani, what's the name of the book?
I have no idea.
Oh, I thought I was giving you a chance to shine. You understand that? I thought for sure you were going to. There hasn't a book I've mentioned that Kalani hadn't read. That's why.
It's okay. You tee him up, and I'll absolutely swing away at him, though. I don't know. We'll see what happens.
That was air, buddy. That was air. Okay.
Hey, man. Hey, 4 weeks, one air ball. I'm okay with that.
Absolutely, my friend.
Sorry about that.
So the author's name is what?
James Davis, if I remember
James
correctly.
James Davis. Okay. I'll have to look that up. I like that. That's kind of interesting.
It was a cool aspect.
Interesting. Okay. So you woke up one day and decided, I'm going to start helping these small business people. What background do you have, experience that led you to believe, I think I can actually help them, right? What are the skill sets necessary to do what you do?
Well, I call this my third career. I've had two of them prior to this, and they've both been pretty good. The first one was my family business. My grandfather opened up a small loan company in 1929, and when I got out of college, we had 70 offices up and down the East Coast. And my job was to go out and visit these offices to make sure that people were showing up for work, we were actually playing by the rules, blah, blah, blah. So I've kind of been in this entrepreneurial space forever. But then when that business started to come to an end, I went to work for Countrywide. And I was one of the first 100 people that they hired to launch their subprime loan product.
I was going to say, oh, you're one of those guys.
I'm one of those guys.
Which, by the way, I loved those guys. I bought a lot of property with no doc loans. If you knew how to do it right, that was Countrywide was a great supplier of helping small business people move the needle a little bit on the financial sector?
Well, as long as I was a commission-only sales rep for them, life was great. I had a ball. We were a wholesale arena, and so my clients were mortgage brokers, which were mom-and-pop shops for the most part. And when I got down here, I realized that was the most fun I ever had, was when I was out running around on the street, going and making presentations, talking to these mortgage brokers. And I had a ball teaching them how to do business, how to do the mortgage business, and helping them how to grow their business. So I had a little bit of a background in it. Countrywide eventually promoted me, and that got to be, and so I got out of it.
Yeah.
And so it's that experience that I think I can bring to a new business, because I had to figure out my own, because everything I'd been taught about sales and marketing in corporate America was no longer applicable. Being a one-person business is a completely different thing. And the key ingredient, in my opinion, is self-confidence. Knowing that you know what it is you're doing, how to talk about it, and how to go out, actually meet some people, and get them interested in what you're doing.
Let's take a break, and we'll come back. We'll dig into your business. You are listening to Local Biz Now. I am Joe Vagnone. I'm here with Kalani Thomas, the owner and founder of Help Desk Sales. And if it's Friday morning, your business matters. We'll be right back to talk with Steve and Underdog Business Strategies. If you're thinking about starting a small business, Steve is here to help you with it. And we are back. You are listening to Local Biz Now. I am Joe Vagnone. I'm here with Kalani Thomas. He is the owner and founder of Help Desk Sales, just a premier sales organization that has got a one price, one stop shop for whatever your needs are for a business owner. Also, we're still speaking with Steve, the owner and founder of Underdog Business Strategies, and you actually help small business owners
absolutely
get started.
Mm-hmm.
Off the air, we were talking about this. Which we don't know the title, and we're going to get the title of this book, Talk to 100 People. I love that concept. Off the air, you said that's the first piece of advice that you give somebody is, let's go talk to your customers.
Yes. You have a business idea. You think it's a great idea. Well, that's terrific, but does anybody else think it's a good idea? Let's go talk to somebody. Let's figure out who do you think your ideal client might actually be. Let's go find them on LinkedIn. Let's connect with them and ask them to go to have a cup of coffee. And then tell them, this is what I'm thinking of doing. What do you think? Does this make any sense?
See, when I tell small business people that very same thing, right, which means I could be a genius, right?
Because
I'm thinking like you, right?
So,
They are afraid to start the process because they don't want to mess up what could be a really good client, right, or process. They want to make sure their name is right, the logo is right, their pitch is right before they go, because they don't want to mess up the five people in their minds that could be good lead generators. What do you say to those people?
Well, I run into that a lot, and I had that same fear myself, but I realized that when is your business really a business? I mean, you're just going through some motions in the beginning. You're just trying to figure out, do I really have a value proposition here that means anything?
Right.
And so these first conversations are just research. You're not trying to sell anybody anything. You don't even know what your pitch is. You're not pitching anything. You're just asking, hey, look, Joe, I know that you're a business broker. What do you think about using LinkedIn in your business? If you could use LinkedIn, do you think that would be help you meet more clients? And just put some potential value propositions in front of somebody that you think might be an intelligent and a worthwhile client, and get their feedback. Let them tell you what the value is.
Yeah, it's just listen.
Yeah, it's just an idea. I always like when people vote with their money, right? So taking an idea to someone and saying, here's what I want to do, and that person going, that's a good idea, here's money, that's all the validation you need to know you're going in the right direction. And without talking to anyone, you're just having ideas with yourself in the mirror, and you're never going to pay yourself, so how do you validate it, right?
Well, and you know, Steve said something so important. He calls it a value proposition. The key word there is value. The client has to see and believe that there's value. So you could have this great concept, this great product, this great service, but the value is between what you can sell it for and make money and what the client's willing to pay, right? How close are they? And that is the key here. And what you're saying is, let's go find that out.
Yeah, what are they willing to pay the money for? What is it that they are going to achieve? What are they going to have as a result of doing business with you that they didn't have before? I mean, the two biggest motivators are, what problem can you solve or what result can you cause? And, you know, when I first met Kalani and I heard about this right price coaching method, I realized that he can help me get clients faster.
Yeah.
That's what I want.
Right. So now let's talk about that. How do you work with your clients? What is your model in working with small business clients? Because I can't imagine they flow in your money your way by the hundreds of thousands. Now, I could be wrong, but the small business owners I know that are getting started, they got about $17 in their pocket, right? And thousands of dollars worth of bills and expectations before they get started.
And they gotta eat lunch today,
walk me
too,
through that.
Oh, man.
Tell me what that looks like.
Well, I beat my head against the wall trying to figure that out. I was a brand new business owner. I have zero brand value. I'm trying to go out in the marketplace, trying to convince somebody to hire me to help them. And I must have gone through, I went through four different business models. None of them worked. Met Kalani, heard about this right price coaching thing. I hired him. Why'd you hire me, Steve? Well, you got to tell me how that model works. I don't
okay,
get it.
Okay, give me the secret.
I don't understand that. And he explained it, and I went, oh, my God, it's so easy. That's exactly the way to do this, especially for startup players, because it's a one-year gig. Hire me, pay me the $600, and let's go. And I will walk you through these six critical questions. And if we get through them, and we will get through them, the key ingredient or the key results are, number one, you're being confident in what it is you're actually trying to do. And number two, what is the highest and best use of your time? What should you be doing all day long?
So I got so many questions for you. I know we're not. We only got about 9 minutes left. So let's try and run through this.
Okay, cool.
Because I want to get to your six key startup questions. Right? You may not be able to answer, but I want people to hear them.
Okay.
But first, I want to ask, what can your clients expect from you? Right? What is it if I pick up the phone and call you and hire you? What is it I'm actually going to be receiving from you?
Well, I think the main thing you're going to be receiving from me is this. Before you can wow anybody with the work that you do, first you have to intrigue someone with words. And it's intrigue someone with words. That's the key. Who is the someone and what words are you going to put in front of them to cause them to go, I want to talk to you.
Intrigue someone with words, and you're going to help me do that.
Absolutely.
Spectacular. Okay, so here's the next question. Answer them quickly so we can get started on this, Steve.
Lightning round. Let's go.
if they want to reach you, buddy, how can they reach you?
I have an email address, which is steve@underdog704.com, and I still prefer email. And my text messaging is 610-322-8733.
One more time, buddy. This is radio. You got to say it twice.
610-322-8733 is my cell phone, and my email address is steve@underdog704.com.
And that is Underdog Business Strategies. Okay, here are the six key startup questions, okay? And we've only got about 4 or 5 minutes, okay? This is painful for you, isn't it, that you got to be fast at this?
I like being fast.
Kalani, you might have to help him with this. Okay?
I'm taking notes. Let's go.
Number one, who is your ideal client? We kind of talked about that, right, to get started.
Most of my clients are in the B2B arena, and therefore, their ideal client is probably going to be the owner of a business. And so we can go on LinkedIn. You can put in into the search tool, and you can find owners of businesses in Charlotte. Go connect with them. Go have a cup of coffee.
So the second thing, you want to add something to that, Kalani?
Nope.
Okay. Second thing is, what do they want you to achieve for them? And you've got underneath here, it's a value proposition. It's the why.
What can you help them achieve? It's not what you do that matters. Nobody cares about what you do. What they care about is the result they're going to get. What problem are you going to solve? That's what motivates people to make the decision.
That's funny you say that, because I'm having trouble getting someone to cut my grass, right? And I had somebody show up, and I said, listen, let me make this real clear for you. Your job, why I'm hiring, is not to cut the grass. It's so when I walk out on this deck with a cup of coffee in the morning, I feel good about what I see. That's what I'm after, right?
That's what I want.
Other than that, let it grow. I don't care, right? So number three, what might they pay? So we're talking about value and price again.
Mm-hmm. When you do figure out who your niche market is, when your ideal client is going to have a big input on how much they're going to pay you. You can name any price you want. It's your business, right? But if your target market doesn't have the money, you got a problem.
Okay. Number four. How might you meet them? How do you meet your client, correct? What is their way to do that?
My favorite, my secret weapon is LinkedIn. LinkedIn has a search engine. It lets me put in 14 different filters. I can define who my ideal client is. Let's go connect with them. Let's go meet them.
Okay. Number five. What words will intrigue them to think about you?
The intriguing words is copywriting. It's putting the right words on paper that's going to get somebody's attention. It's going to get them to go, oh, wow, I do want to have a cup of coffee with Kalani.
Capitalize on those micro moments, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, it's interesting that you're saying that because a lot of these are wording and wordsmithing some concepts that I've been helping my sister try and get started. And she spends weeks trying to come up with some stuff that frustrates her because it is a difficult challenge to say, is this right? Is it working? Is it connecting? And you're going to help them do that.
Absolutely.
Okay. Number six, how to build your business.
Once you have the opportunity to meet somebody face to face, now what? Now what are you going to do? And so this is what I call building your business. And the people that you've met face to face are prospects. They may never buy from you, but they know who you are. And they can be connectors, and they can be allies, and you want to be able to stay in touch with them. And I'm a big fan of drip email campaigns to those people.
Okay. What about clients that aren't B2B? Is there a different strategy you would take other than, say, LinkedIn?
Even if you're in the B2C marketplace, your consumer still probably has a job. They probably do something for a living. And if we can start to figure out and how to categorize those people into terms of what do they do for a living, we can piece together some words that are going to appeal to their career.
Steve, we've only got about a minute left, buddy. What piece of advice would you give this small business person right now listening, thinking about getting started?
Truthfully, get somebody to help you. Get somebody that's, I don't care who they are. I don't care if they're a copywriter, a coach, a consultant, but somebody that can just help you think through the process. Because thinking inside your own head all day long, you come out of every one of those meetings going, wow, that was a great meeting with myself.
Right. I still don't have a check or a commitment, but it's great for me. Thank you. Steve, thank you so much, my friend. I really appreciate you spending the time to come here today, buddy.
My pleasure. Thank you all. Thank you.
You are listening to Local Biz Now. If it's Friday morning, that's right. We got all kind of spectacular quality.